Joining us now in Hot Copy, House Deputy Speaker Rufus Rodriguez. Good morning, Congressman, and thank you so much for joining us.
Mayong bunta. Good morning, Ms. Rain.
The House Justice Committee found that the complainant lacked knowledge and authenticated documents to back his claims against Justice Leonen. Does this mean that this is more of a judgment on the credibility of the complainant and complaint rather than an assessment of whether Justice Leonen should be tried at all for the culpable violation of Constitution and betrayal of public trust? Congressman.
Well, this is really following the rules of the Committee of Justice in the House of Representatives, which have the rules on the rules of impeachment. And in this particular case, our rules require that there should be personal knowledge of the facts alleged in the complaint, or the complaint is based on authentic records. So that is the focus of the first hearing, sufficiency informed. And clearly, what was found, what we found in the complaint are all Xerox copies of columns and news reports from newspapers and online reports. So they did not comply. These allegations will not comply with the rules of impeachment because there was no instance or allegation which was of personal knowledge of the complainant, nor were any document authentic. So therefore, all of them will be therefore be hearsay, and there can be no credibility because hearsay is not allowed in any proceedings, Ms. Rain.
Hearsay, and you also mentioned travesty in previous reports. What did Leonen have that he was able to be absolved of this impeachment complaint that perhaps the late former Chief Justice Renato Corona didn't have in 2011, or even President Joseph Estrada and Ombudsman Mercedes Gutierrez?
Well, on the part of the case of Chief Justice Sereno, it was the Supreme Court. They have a different procedure. This one is in the House, and we have exactly exact precise rules of impeachment, and that has to be followed. And the same also, we were mentioning about the others in the House. These, probably these particular cases of Gutierrez and the other would become pass the threshold of the sufficiency test of form. But in this particular case, since not one of the annexes and the allegations pertain to personal knowledge, and these are all hearsay, it comes from reports from newspapers, and there is no authentic document following our rules. Clearly, it is really clearly hearsay and a travesty, because you don't file a case based on newspaper reports. We were acting as a judicial body in that case to find out whether there is sufficient grounds. So the first step, form. Second, substance. We didn't even go to the substance anymore, because how can there be substance? How can we go to substance when all the allegations and all the annexes are hearsay, Ms. Rain?
What about the remarks of fellow lawmakers that the House should not even bother or spend 5 months on this complaint while it should be working on COVID-related legislation? Even Leonen himself feels the time could have been better spent on seeking ways to help the country recover from the pandemic.
Yes, Ms. Rain, precisely. The first instance that we have, first, there is a procedure, filing with the Secretary General, referral of the Secretary General to the Speaker, the Speaker to the committee. Then the committee precisely met, and for that first instance in that hearing, we do not want to anymore continue with the proceedings because, as I've said, it's hearsay. Let us use our time, all of us members, instead of having a hearing for hearsay allegations, we should now go into our measures to recover from the pandemic. In fact, Bayanihan 3 has already been approved in the House, is going to the Senate. So we agree that we should be able to focus on this pandemic and not on this hearsay allegations in the impeachment complaint against Justice Leonen.
Deputy Speaker Leonen, in his reaction, alluded to these cases as having been due to narrow, parochial, selfish gains. and an attempt to destroy institutions to satisfy greed and power. The 44 who voted to dismiss the complaint, would you say that they can see through the case as well and not just dismissed on the basis of a lack of evidence?
Well, of course, there were allegations that that this case is politically motivated, that the filing of this is a result of some case that was pending in the Supreme Court. You know, Ms. Rain, we in the House of Representatives in the Committee on Justice will not go into motives of filing. We'll go into what was the reason. We have to go into the evidence before us. So what was the evidence or non-evidence before the committee? As I have said earlier, clearly we decided based on what we see, the complaint and the annexes. And so I have said we discard any of the allegedly the motive, the speculations about this, and go directly to the evidence, because that is our duty, to find out first whether there is sufficiency in form and in substance, and if they comply with the two, we go to the hearing so that we can have the determination of sufficient grounds for impeachment. In the first instance, in that first hearing, on the hearing of sufficiency of form, clearly the evidence or non-evidence would show all are hearsay, not admissible in any proceedings, Ms. Ryan. Mm-hmm.
Deputy Speaker, now that this is over, this complaint was endorsed by Ilocos Norte Representative Angelo Marcos Barba, a cousin of former Senator Bongbong Marcos. Do you see now this complaint as a retaliation for Justice Leonen having penned the decision, junking the electoral protest of Marcos against now Vice President Lenny Robredo?
Well, it is true that the endorser of the complaint, as required by the rules of impeachment of the House, is one member of the House, the Honorable Angelo Barba. Yes, he is a cousin of former senator, a candidate for Vice President Bongbong Marcos. But once again, I would, in my own personal feeling, I would not go into any motive, any speculation. We will decide, and I read this, studied the case carefully, read all of these allegations, and I could say that they are dismissible without any regard to any possible speculation on the reason of the filing of this case, Ms. Rain.
Mm-hmm. Now that the impeachment proceedings can be initiated or cannot be initiated against Leonen within a year, what do you think this might mean for his critics? What would it have meant to the Supreme Court if Leonen had been successfully removed from office?
Well, first of all, yes, the one-year ban kicks in. Well, but the critics have to abide with that. The critics of Leonen would therefore be, they can wait. If they want to file, they can file after 1 year. And it starts yesterday, because that is where the proceeding started. So 1 year ban. You cannot file a case against an impeachable official once it has been filed and it has been acted upon. You have to wait for 1 year. So for the critics, that is what they can do. They can wait and prepare and probably be able to have more evidence which are directly of their own personal knowledge and authentic documents. Well, I would believe that if Leonen was removed from office, the Supreme Court will not have a voice of independence, a voice of probity, a voice who decides based on the facts of the case, the evidence, and his conscience. So I have read decisions. I teach in the San Sebastian College of Law, and I see decisions and find very reasonable, well-researched decisions of Justice Leonen. So that would, therefore, if he was removed, it will be a setback to the entire collegial body, the Supreme Court.
Mm-hmm. Finally, what is the next course of action in the dismissal of this impeachment complaint against Leonen, Deputy Speaker?
Well, because of the decision to dismiss it, we are going to do two things, the committee. First, under the rules, we have to send back this complaint to the Secretary General with the written explanation on why it is not sufficient in form. So that is the first step. The second step is to prepare already a committee report that will report the dismissal, the outright dismissal of this case, meaning end, it ends the proceedings, and we will give it to the plenary for approval. And the plenary will not vote on that because this is entirely, it will just for giving notice to the plenary, because under our rules, precisely, it's the committee that will first decide on whether we were going to continue with a case or not, and decided, and the committee decided to dismiss the case.
Understood. Meanwhile, we'll be watching out for further developments in the House before it adjourns sine die on June 3rd. House Deputy Speaker Rufus Rodriguez, thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us. A pleasure to speak with you today. Thank you.
Daghang salamat. Thank you very much, Ms. Rain.
Daghang salamat.